This was the hardest category to trim down. We had to lose three Rosie Perez stories. We had to lose two William H. Macy stories. Best story told on the show in the last year. Do it.
And now the SUI nominees for Best Story Told on the Show. Tim Kirchen, Cinderella Birthday Party.
We had a fifth birthday party for my daughter for Cinderella. And Cinderella showed up, and I think she was 65 years old. And I think she was drunk. And she came down into our basement and put on the single worst performance in the history of kids' birthdays. And my mother, God bless her, looked at my father, God rest his soul, and said, "Jeff, you have to save this party." And my father, the funniest man ever, got up and became Cinderella's assistant and saved the day because she was the worst Cinderella of all time. We were expecting Helen Hunt, and we got Helen Hayes. It was awful.
Richard Lewis's Larry David dinner story.
He calls me up and he says, "Let's go to dinner." And I go, "What time?" He goes, 4:01. I go, 4:01. I said, "I just had a sandwich." He said, "All right, then we had it. We were on it for 45 minutes. He says, 4:18, 5:11, 6:12. I went, "What are you, what, an airport controller on acid? What the hell is going on with you?" You know, he's a very wealthy man. I make a good living. I've been working my whole life. But, he doesn't have to treat me. Screw him. So I go to this fancy restaurant in Beverly Hills. I get there an hour early. We're supposed to meet at 5:56 for dinner, okay? I go to the maitre d'. I go, "Here's my credit card." "Oh, Mr. Lewis, no, Mr. David always pays." I'm like, "No, screw Mr. David. I could pay for him." "No, no, he'll yell at us." I don't let him yell at you, you babies.
Yeah.
"I'm paying." Uh-huh. So I give my credit card. Larry comes an hour late. We were always broke for years when we started. And I said, "Larry, why don't we just order what we used to do? I'd order chicken, you'd order beef, you'd get some soup, we'd split it." And he says, "No, don't embarrass me." I go, "What do you mean embarrass you? The chef will tell me what I want." "The chef will tell you what you want? What are you, nutcase? How do you changed on me? What kind of..." So the chef brings out 20 dishes on one of these Lazy Susans, and we don't even speak for more than 1 minute. And the phone rings, and he goes, "Oh, my God, I forgot. It's poker night at Steve Martin's house," and he leaves me.
You have to pay for it.
He leaves me with 20 entrees and a $1,200 bill.
Paul DeGelder getting attacked by a shark.
A bull shark came up from underneath me and grabbed me by the right hamstring and the right hand in the same bite. You know, I've seen Discovery Channel, I've seen the crocodile hunter jab it in the eyeball, but I can't because my hand is in the shark's mouth as well. So I try with my left hand, but I can't reach it. I try to push it off by the nose, but that just pushes the teeth of the lower jaw further into my leg. And that's when it starts to get painful. And then I try to punch it in the head, but that didn't do anything except I think f*** it off, because that's when it started to shake me. That's when it got really painful, and I can't even describe to you how excruciating this was. The teeth of a bull shark work as a saw when it shakes its head. So it's sawing the flesh out of my body. It's drowning me at the same time. Towards the end of those 8 to 10 seconds, I had basically accepted that I was not going home that day. I realized that I'd lived so much already that if I was going to go, then that's cool. I'm good with that. And I stopped and I was ready to go. And then I stopped being thrashed around. And my wetsuit made me positively buoyant. So I popped to the surface. I saw the shark's tail splash water in my face. And I realized that I was still alive. And I had to get out of that water or the shark was going to come back and finish me off. So I started to swim and I took my hand out of the water. But my hand wasn't there. And my arm ended at the end of my wetsuit. So my medical training kicked in. I thought, okay, well, I've got to keep that wound above my heart to stem bleeding. So I keep that out of the water. I'm swimming with one hand, and I can't even feel my right leg. I don't know what's wrong with it. I just can't feel it. So I'm swimming with one hand and one leg, trying to get back to the safety boat while they're coming towards me. And the guys in the boat later told me that I was swimming through a pool of my own blood. And when they got in close, they could actually taste it in the air. It was that thick.
J.K. Simmons, Tutu Grams.
Yes, I did Tutu Grams.
Tutu Grams.
Tutu Grams.
Can I get one right? I'd love to buy one right now. What would they cost?
Right now they would cost $500,000. And I will come to your house with some balloons and a tutu.
Right. Yeah. How is your singing?
I was a trained singer. I was singing, like, you know, opera and, you know, art songs and Brahms and Beethoven before that. But for the tutu grams, they wanted, like incredibly macho-looking dudes such as myself, right, with facial hair, preferably. But we had to sing in falsetto. Was the final ultimate embarrassment. So yeah, we'd go sing, you know, happy birthday or, you know, whatever. Try and embarrass the people at their place of work, but what we mostly did was embarrass ourselves.
David Sampson on the Marlins killing Muhammad Ali.
June 3rd, 2016, I was minding my own business in the seventh inning when I got a call saying Muhammad Ali had died. And I knew Muhammad Ali, and I knew the person who called would absolutely have that information. And I was incredibly sad and surprised. And I said, I'm so sorry. And I hung up. And the first call I made at the time was to the person running in-game entertainment. And I said, listen, Muhammad Ali just died. Get it on the board with a picture of Muhammad Ali with his death date of June 3rd, 2016, so he can get a nice ovation. Because he had been there when Marlins Park opened. He's an icon, and I wanted to do our part in honoring his memory. All of a sudden, the game ends, and on the board, I'm sitting in the seat, on the big Jumbotron in center field comes this glorious picture of a young Muhammad Ali announcing that he was dead. So meanwhile, my phone starts buzzing and ringing like crazy, and I don't know what's going on. And the only thing I remember reacting to was this text from Levitard saying, you just killed Ali. So I finally find a way to look, and there's not one article, not one anything that Ali is dead. So my first call was to PJ Loiello, the PR guy. I said, PJ, come see me. I think we have a situation. I told him what was going on, and the only thing he said to me, I guess this is what happens when you have a master's degree, he said, you sure as heck better hope that he's dead, because if not, you better get to Louisville and take care of it yourself. So I said, thanks, PJ. That's really quite helpful. So I'm wondering, do I have to meet the media? Do I have to say, I'm sorry, I thought he was dead, but he's not dead, but he's dying. He could be dead. He's not going to be dead. All this is going on. Finally, somebody broke the news that he was dead. Once it comes out that he died, I then only had to start my work. I spoke to his family, and I spoke to his representatives that night because I was mortified. They had not released a statement. They hadn't done a thing, and they did forgive me. It took 2 days, but they forgave me. They did not want the news to come out that way. They understood what happened.
Are you guys absorbing this?
Yes.
The Ali family wanted to announce the death of Muhammad Ali the right way, and
David did it on a jumbo trunk.
Dan's awkward interaction with doctor during testicular ultrasound.
So yesterday, I have to have a testicular ultrasound. Bear of a man explains to me what I have to do. And what I have to do is I have to get on my back on a slab, throw my legs up in the air. Yeah, I need to cup my package with my left hand. Again, legs up in the air on my back. As I'm on this table on my back, and it's being explained that the gel is very cold and it's going to take about 6 or 7 minutes, and there's going to be a wand, an ultrasound wand that is waved over, you know, the ultrasounded areas. As all of this is being explained to me, I'm there on my back just shaking my head like, how has my life arrived here? I'm saying to myself as I'm doing this, it can't get worse than this. It simply can't. This is the worst thing to ever happen to me. He looks me straight in the eye for the first time. And I'm in this position before the wand and the gel, and here we go. We're about to get started. And he says, I am such a big fan of your TV and radio shows.
You say anything about me?
Yes, actually, which is how we ended up in the next 7 minutes of conversation, where at various points, he's laughing because I'm yelling at him about all of this, right? At this point, I'm like, dude, like, that's the time you choose to tell me that.
But you're laughing?
I am laughing. I'm also mystified. I'm vulnerable. I'm still scared.
It sounds like he had a ball.
Billy's terrible celebrity encounter.
I'm a crazy person, as you may or may not know, and I'm, you know, concerned about everything. And last year, there was a hurricane that came in and knocked out power down here for a week for a lot of people. So I did not want to be in that situation. So I noticed about a month ago that there's this company that's been advertising on TV, like during the commercial breaks for our shows, where it's like this generator that immediately turns on when your power goes out. And I'm like, you know what? That seems like a good thing to have. And they're like, oh, free consultation and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, what can it hurt to go to this website and sign up and have someone come and see how much it would cost? So I did that, and I gave two different phone numbers because I wanted to make sure that they would get here in time for hurricane season, because I do not want to be without power. It's so hot and gross when there's no power. Like, I need air conditioning more than anything. So finally, yesterday, the guy calls me, and he's like, hey, I'm calling to see about the thing. And I'm like, yeah, you know, actually, you called my house yesterday, and we set up a, you know, a thing, and they're going to come, you know, in a couple weeks to give an estimate and walk us through whatever. So I think that's the end of the conversation, and I'm like, you know, thanks, whatever. I'm getting ready to hang up. And it's a call from Wisconsin, which is a miracle I even picked up, because I never pick up calls I don't know.
Does this story come complete with an ending?
We'll get there. So the guy, when I'm about to hang up, goes, let me ask you something. Your voice sounds familiar. Are you on the Levitard show?
Whoa.
And I'm like, wow, I am.
Yeah.
It's so cool that, you know, you recognize me. And I'm like, you know what? Well, your advertising actually works, because your advertising on the show is what got me to call the company. And then he's like, oh, wow, yeah. And then
okay, so
like,
it doesn't come with
yeah,
it.
Yeah, there's no real ending.
Mina,
that's
can
just
you tell
it.
Me what your thoughts are? $2 go to the penalty box. Another $2.
Just hey, because ain't free. Time for some ads.
Two more minutes.
Or? Just because I had to listen to it again. How are you so bad at this? DraftKings, money's being made around.